How was the last one?
All the same. Let's get going.
Jesus sinners does receive. Excellent.
Don't worry, it's okay, I
still be gone. That excuses everything. Now, Book of Exodus, a very important book. Exodus. Now, big picture stuff. And I'll come back to this. What is it that makes the nation of Israel special, different?
From every other nation?
From every other nation.
God chose them.
Number one, God chose them. And he chose them for what purpose? To make them different, to make them better.
To show his love.
Okay. What purpose?
Well, the access to them. God had access to them and they had access to God.
Right.
To bless all the earth through them.
Righto, partly to bless the earth through them so that they would have access to him, and that, or another way of putting it, is that they would be a holy nation. They're not just any nation, but they are a holy nation with access to him and as mediators of his blessing. Now, I'll spell some of this out as we go. Now, first of all, just obvious stuff, the names. Take notice that in Hebrew, once again, the first words in the Hebrew text are the names. So Shemoth, which in Hebrew is names. If you have a look, these are the names of... Okay? So Shemoth, names, beginning of Exodus. They're the first words of the book. Shem is name, Shemoth, plural, names. The English term is much more theological. It's exodos. Odos is a journey. Ex is out. Exodus, a journey out. A going out, a departure, a procession. But the idea is going out. The Israelites go out from the land of Egypt. They depart from the land of Egypt. They go in procession. They go on a journey from the land of Egypt to Mount Sinai. So Exodus. Now, that's quite helpful because it puts the picture of journey right in the front. Remember how this is important? This is for the rest of the Pentateuch, a journey. Now, what's the importance of this book? Well, this book, if you like, gives Israel's divine constitution, Israel's Magna Carta. Here God gives the foundation for Israel as his holy people, his foundation. And that foundation is given in the covenant that he makes with them at Sinai. Now, they are already his people because of his covenant with Abraham. What he does here is he makes them his holy people. He gives them the tabernacle, the divine service, the priesthood, and everything that goes with that. That's what's added here. Right from ancient history, the Jews were always confronted by the question as to why they regarded themselves as different from all other nations. Now, why are you different? Why do you stay apart? You're stuck up. You think you're better than anybody else. Now, that kind of question. The answer that the Jewish people, the Israelites, gave, if you like, was to point back to the book of Exodus. What makes a difference? Well, this is the story. We are a holy nation. Well, and then the pagan people would say, okay, do you think you're better than other people, morally better? They say, no, we're not a morally perfect nation. We're not a righteous nation. We're not a superior nation. But we are a holy nation. And they'd ask the question, well, what makes you a holy nation? And they would give three answers, and all of them come from the book of Exodus. Why are you a holy nation? Well, God chose us and redeemed us from slavery in Egypt. Now, according to ancient law, if you were a slave and I redeemed you from slavery, redeem is buy free, to whom do you belong? To me. So God redeemed his people, therefore they belong to me. to him by right of redemption. Secondly, God made his covenant with them at Mount Sinai. He made his covenant with them. Please, as part of your homework, read this handout that I've given you about covenants and Near Eastern vassal treaties, which gives you background to this book, but also for your assignment. The third most important answer they gave was that God not only redeemed us so that we belong to God, he made his covenant with us, but in this covenant with us, he gave his presence to us and access to his presence. And by his presence, he makes and keeps us holy. So God gives Israel access to his holy, sanctifying presence. What is it that makes them holy? God does. How does God make them holy? By his presence with them and his interaction with them. And for what purpose did God make them a holy people? Well, since they were a holy people, they had access to God and his blessings. They are holy priestly people. A priest is a person who has access to God. A holy person is a person who has access to God. So they have access to God, they have access to God's blessings, and they can use it for the benefit of others. So the Israelites were called by God to be a holy people, his royal priesthood, and they then were to mediate between God and the nations. There are two sides to it. On the one hand, they bring God's blessing to the nations. On the other hand, they stand in for the nations. They intercede for the nations. They mediate the nations to God. Now, that's the basic structure here of the book. We're coming across these terms, holy people, royal priesthood, as very important words in this book. Any questions?
They don't talk a lot about the Israelites preaching God to the other nations, or the other nations coming to know God through the Israelites.
Not at this stage.
I mean, throughout the Old Testament, yes.
Oh, there's much more there than you... But it's not preaching. It's interesting the way they mediate. It's just, it's not a matter of doing, but it's a matter of being.
Osmosis sort of
stuff. But there is some doing too, and that comes when you see that most clearly in the Psalms. And it has to do with praising God to the nations. And then the other side is that in prayer, they represent the nations before God. But that's filling in this later on, and it only becomes possible with the temple in Jerusalem.
The other nations, even though like, in some cases they do praise God, the true God, they never really come into the blessings, the covenant blessings.
They don't become part of the covenant, but they still receive blessings. Remember God's promise to Abraham?
Appropriation blessings and such like.
Sorry?
They get the appropriation blessings.
Yes.
Those ones, but they don't ever get into the covenant, do they?
They don't get into the covenant with Abraham, because only those who are descendants of Abraham. And the only way that the nations can enter the covenant is through, if you go the whole story, is through Jesus, who is the seed of Abraham. Big picture stuff now. Jesus is the seed of Abraham. It's by being united with Jesus, we people who are not Jews by origin become part of God's covenant with Abraham and heirs of God's promises to Abraham. Now that's New Testament story. That's way down the story.
So the best the Old Testament nations could hope for is getting into the outer part of the temple.
That's right. There's the court of the Gentiles, and then there's a court of the Israelites, and then there's the sanctuary itself. That's part of God's purpose.
The Israelites to bring other nations into that
Well, and it is just by their being. The very fact that they are there in the world, they bring God's blessing. Okay. To not just to themselves, but to others. Yes?
Out of curiosity, if you were to walk into the temple and pass the court that you're allowed into and went to the next one and the one after that, what would happen to you? Would they like kick around the stone?
They had temple police or gatekeepers, which would screen people.
Okay.
And there were certain entrance, what scholars call entrance liturgies, screening of people coming at various points.
Yeah.
And archaeologists have actually discovered a warning on an inscription from the outer court warning anybody who's not a Jew not to go past this point. Well, that if human beings don't do anything, they come under God's judgment. Let's go on. We're jumping ahead with that. Now, the structure of the book, yep. First of all, big picture. You need to see the way Exodus fits in with the other books. I've spoken about that. Exodus is very closely related to Leviticus and Numbers. And the framework that holds these books together is the story of journey in three stages with three different locations. So the journey from Egypt to Sinai, from Sinai to Kadesh, from Kadesh to the plains of Moab. That's the big picture. In each of these three locations, God gives his laws, legislation, which establishes Israel's national institutions. So he is establishing them as his holy nation. In Egypt, he gives them all the laws about the Passover because that's relevant to them there. So the celebration of the Passover, Egypt. At Sinai, he gives them the laws for the divine service and the tabernacle. At Kadesh, he gives laws about the holiness and purity of the priests and the people. Holiness, purity, how can a sinful people live in the presence of a holy God? That's the basic discussion here, and God regulates that. Lastly, on the plains of Moab, at the end of Numbers, you get legislation for life in the promised land. And then that continues then in the book of Deuteronomy, because as you know, the book of Deuteronomy is looking forward to crossing the Jordan, entering the promised land. Now, what's interesting too, is that we would think from a human point of view, that originally everything was good, but then things went bad. But what Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers shows us that right from the beginning, despite God's goodness to his people and everything that God does for them, the people don't get it. And so at each stage of the journey, there is murmuring, complaining, whinging. It's very interesting. There are seven basically acts of whinging, complaining, murmuring is the term. It's a lovely word, murmuring against somebody, murmur. There's the lack of water and food for the first stage of the journey. And then in the second and third stage of the journey, there's murmuring about the power of the Canaanites. Now, God promises us land, but it's impossible because it's inhabited by giants who have this wonderful armaments, fortified cities. It's hopeless. So murmuring against the power of the Canaanites and then murmuring against God for the lack of water and bread again. So each stage has that theme of murmuring. Coming from that to the book itself. Exodus is divided very clearly into two clear, distinct parts. Remember, Genesis goes into three parts. There's the prologue, the primeval history, the history of the fall, and then there's the history of the patriarchs. Now, I don't expect you to have a picture of all the chapters and how they fit together, but I expect you to have a general overview of the big structure. Now, what's important always when you look a book is the structure of the book. What gives you some idea of what the book's about is where it starts and where it ends. Now take notice of this. The book of Exodus ends in a strange place. Let's have a look at it. Exodus chapter 40, 34 to 38. And that helps us understand the purpose of this book. I think we've done the complete circuit, so it's back to you, David. Yeah, it happens all too quickly, doesn't it? Exodus 40.
Yep. Verses just one.
34. Up here. 34 to 38.
All right. Then the cloud covered the tent of meeting, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. Moses could not enter the tent of meeting because the cloud had settled upon it, and the glory of the Lord filled the tabernacle. In all the troubles of the Israelites, whenever the cloud lifted from above the tabernacle, they would set out. But if the cloud did not lift, they did not set out until the day it lifted. So the cloud of the Lord was over the tabernacle by day, and fire was in the cloud by night, in the sight of all the house of Israel during all their travels.
Now there's reference here to the glory cloud. Something funny's going on here. God's glory is his visible presence. But what does God do to his presence? He hides it in a cloud.
It's
hidden presence. So you have the glory cloud. Now take notice of it. It's very significant. The glory cloud appears when the Israelites leave Egypt, remember? They're leaving Egypt, and all of a sudden you have this pillar of cloud by day and fire by night. It looks like a cloud, a pillar. In day, it's a dark cloud. At night time, it glows with fire. It leads them there, and it leads them to the Red Sea. It leads them across the Red Sea, down into the Red Sea, the other side of the Red Sea. And then it disappears, and then it reappears, and disappears, reappears. It leads them all the way where? To which mountain?
Sinai.
Mount Sinai. And then it settles on Mount Sinai. And take notice of some very important stuff. Then after Moses and the people have built the tabernacle, where does the glory cloud go? It leaves the mountain and it comes over the cloud covers the tabernacle. And the glory of God is located where? In the Holy of Holies. And when God wants the people to move on, what happens? The cloud lifts and it goes before the people, and where the cloud stops, that's where the tabernacle is relocated. Leads them all the way to the promised land. Now, why is it that the book of Exodus, which begins with the Israelites enslaved in Egypt, ends with this funny little incident? You have the building of the tabernacle, and then the glory cloud leaving the mountain, covering the tabernacle, and God's glory filling the Holy of Holies.
They can see God's presence.
So it has something to do with God's presence. Could I put it in? Can I get another way? For what purpose did God rescue his people from Egypt?
To be praised.
No.
So they could bless them?
What?
So they'd have access to him?
So they'd have access to him, so that he could travel with them. So he could join them and travel with them. And they could have access to him, not up in heaven, but
on earth.
For what purpose did God redeem his people? So that he could join them on their journey to the promised land, so that he can bring them to the promised land, and so that they could access him at all stages of their journey. They don't have to go back to Mount Sinai. Why? Because the tabernacle is a mobile Mount Sinai. You see the way it is? Yep.
What exactly is a tabernacle? Like, is it a big stone wall that's like slow moves, or like?
You can look at the description of later on. We go to Numbers. I've given you a diagram of it. It's a tent, a mobile tent. Just very briefly. Oh gosh, Its full arrangement is like this. It consists of two squares, except there's no clear division here. The centre of this part is the Holy of Holies. You have a tent, Holy of Holies, holy place. And the centre, what?
Is the Holy of Holies another tent within it? Or
it's a part within the tent. I'll explain that just in a minute, just very briefly. And then out here you have the altar for burnt offering, and you have the entrance here, and you have a courtyard. You have a screen around the outside with one entrance. Okay, so that's the tabernacle. The tabernacle can be one of two things. The tabernacle can be the tabernacle plus the courtyard, or it can be the tent here, which is the whole of this building, or it sometimes is the Holy of Holies. Now, this is a tent, but within the tent you had a wooden cube, which was, yes, a wooden cube, which had, you know, four sides, so a cube like that, with open-ended here, and this curtain dividing this from this. Right, so this is a wooden cube, exactly square. And what's in the Holy of Holies? The Ark of the Covenant, and what's on top of the Ark? Before that, on top of the Ark you have angels that form the mercy seat, and that together forms a throne, and on this throne there's nobody visible. Why? Because the Ark of the Covenant and the mercy seat is the throne of God, the invisible God. So the Ark is a box. On the box you have the angels, and they form a throne. Hey, do you get it? That's just rough diagram. Okay, now, who's only allowed to go into the Holy of Holies? When?
Once a year.
When?
Past.
No.
Day of Atonement.
You know your theology. Okay, only on the Day of Atonement is the is the high priest allowed to go in the Holy of Holies. But every day, the priest on duty enters the holy place. There's a curtain, a two-layered curtain here, which, you know, you go through that. It forms a sort of a passageway. You go one side and then like that. Out here you have three pieces of furniture. There's the lamp. There is the incense altar here. There is a lampstand here. And then there's a table for showbread. Now, every day the priest on duty as part of the divine service enters the holy place and burns incense on the altar in front of the Holy of Holies every morning, every evening. But the focus of worship is not here. If people want to meet with God, they don't go into the Holy of Holies. They meet God where? At the altar. God comes from here to here, and his people meet him at the altar. We will be looking more closely at that, so I don't want to go any further with that. Yes?
The cloud.
Yes, the cloud.
Because at the start, the cloud's enveloping the whole thing, and Moses can't enter it.
Yes.
When does the cloud retract into the Holy of Holies, or we don't see it anymore?
It's there sometimes, it's not there other times.
Okay.
Right? But the cloud is bigger than the glory. The glory is contained in the cloud. Yeah. So if you think in terms of Mount Sinai, the glory is the top of the mountain. The cloud covers the whole body of the mountain. So the cloud covers this whole thing, but the glory is found in here.
Okay.
And the location of glory is the mercy seat.
Yep.
Very significant stuff. Very deep theology here. Righto, now, that's the big picture, and I'm going to unpack it. Now, in what follows? Very profound theology and fundamental theology, Old Testament, but also for us in the New Testament. Now, as I said, the book of Exodus falls into two parts. The first part is the procession, the journey from Egypt to, not the Promised Land, but to Mount Sinai. Now, 1 to 18 or 19, depends on how you divide it. It begins with the commission of Moses to be the deliverer. to be God's servant, God's agent. And God gives Moses the strangest weapon, instrument ever given to any human being. He is to take on Pharaoh, who is not just the head of a superpower, you know, the Obama of the ancient world, but he's also the incarnation of the most superior God of all gods, the sun god. And God gives Moses one thing. That's incidental. His name. His holy name, Yahweh. And by the use of that name, he does everything. So there's the commission of Moses and the gift of his proper name to Moses. I'm going to look more closely at that because there's a lot here that's not evident to us modern people. Then from, that's chapter 1 to 4, Moses goes to Egypt and then there is a battle that begins. From a human point of view, it looks like a battle between Moses, the human being, and Pharaoh. It looks like a battle between the Israelites and the Egyptians. But behind Moses and Pharaoh, you have a battle between gods. You have spiritual warfare going on. You have the Lord who opposes Pharaoh and all the gods of Egypt. Out of the gods of Egypt, this is spiritual warfare. This is theological warfare.
The other gods never even get a shot.
They do, but they are front men. They have their fronts. Just as the Lord doesn't appear, Moses represents Yahweh. You need to understand that the Egyptians, like all people in the ancient world, believed that there were three classes of gods. Three classes of gods, supernatural beings. There are the sky gods. There are the earth gods, or goddesses. They are mainly goddesses. And then there were the underworld gods. Now, do you understand underworld? Sky up there, earth here, underworld, what's under our feet.
Yeah.
Now, the chief sky god is
Amun-Ra,
who is the sun god. Amun-Ra. Now, the chief underworld god is... Greek. His name is Seth. He's a nasty guy. His icon is crocodile or the hippopotamus. Now, according to Egyptian theology, just look at this because it makes sense of what follows. There's a battle between Seth and Amon-Ra for control of which domain?
The earth.
Now, the sky god is the god of order. The Egyptian word for that is Maat. Seth is the god of death. Chaos. Right? So you have order, chaos. Now, the sky god does is every day he descends from his throne up there and he goes where?
Across the sky.
He goes across the sky and at sunset he enters the
underworld
and he deals battle with Seth and all the other nasties there, the ghosts and the demons and other nasty gods of chaos. He doesn't actually defeat them, but he puts them back in their box. He keeps them for another day. Righto? And then in the morning, what does he do?
The sky.
He rises victorious and announces his victory to whom?
The
people on earth. Now that's Egyptian theology in a nutshell. It's much more complicated than that, but that's in a nutshell is Egyptian theology. Now, how does Pharaoh fit into it? Well, Pharaoh has supernatural power. He has magic, sorcery. But that's a Christian Jewish term. He has supernatural powers. And his job, since he is the incarnation of the sun god, He himself is a god. He performs the rituals every morning and every evening to make sure that the sun god is safe when he goes into the underworld, to protect the sun god when he goes down into the underworld, and then to make sure that the sun god has the power to rise, to get out, to escape the underworld. Okay, so the Pharaoh is king, he's priest, he is magician, he's all that role together. And so what's the battle between Moses and Pharaoh? Behind Pharaoh you have all supernatural powers. And Moses is just a human being. There's a funny battle going here. But the battle is between God and the gods of Egypt. Let's have a look at two passages which make that quite clear, or three passages. Here we are. Chapter 6, verse 6. Stephen, I think it's your turn. 6, 6, 7, 4, and 12, 12.
Therefore, say to the Israelites, I am the Lord, and I will bring you out from under the yoke of the Egyptians. I will free you from being slaves to them, and I will redeem you with an outstretched arm and with mighty acts of judgment.
Redeem means rescue, set free from slavery. God will set them free with an outstretched arm. Now, that's a military picture. The picture here is of God, the general, the commander-in-chief. And what's this gesture?
Go
into battle, right? The outstretched arm is the order, the gesture that a general makes for attack, to charge. Okay, so with outstretched arm, with outstretched hand and a mighty arm, you have find this term going again and again, and with acts of judgment. Now, acts of judgment against whom? Now, judgment we see negatively in English. No, punishing people. But judgment in Hebrew means it has that, but the basic idea to judge is to put right. So you intervene to put something that's wrong right. Now, who are God's judgments against? Let's have a look. 7 verse 4. The battle is against whom? 7 verse 4, can you read that too?
He will not listen to you. Then I will lay my hand on Egypt, and with mighty acts of judgment, I will bring out my divisions, my people, the Israelites.
Now notice the term, I will bring out my divisions, as a military term, is the armies. God has 12 human armies. What are the 12 human armies, the divisions?
The
12 tribes of Israel. You got it, spot on, you got into the picture. So God's divisions are the 12 tribes of Israel. Notice that, once again, it's a military attack. The picture is warfare. And who is it against? Now we go to chapter 12, verse 12. Please, Stephen.
On that same night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, both men and animals, and I will bring judgment on all the gods of Egypt. I am the Lord.
Who will God bring judgment on?
The gods
of Egypt. Now what happens then is Pharaoh uses God's name to demand that Moses uses God's name to demand that Pharaoh lets God's people go. Pharaoh refuses, and so the battle begins. And there are 10 battles leading to the final war. So you get the picture? You get 10 battles, and then there's the final culminating battle. Now, the 10 battles are the so-called 10 plagues. And you start off, there are three, the first three have to do with God's attack on the powers of the underworld. The next three have to do with the land. And the last, from up to 9, you have the sky gods. And number 10 is the incarnation of the sun god, Pharaoh's son.
Yeah.
But can you see? So you get the battle between God and the gods of Egypt, starting from the bottom, going all the way up to the top. And in each domain, God proves to be the victor. And if I can give you the big picture going on further, then the Israelites leave Egypt and Pharaoh and his armies chase them. Where does God lead them to? Into the sea. Now the sea leads you where? The sea leads you into the underworld. God, instead of Pharaoh going down into the underworld, God himself goes down into the underworld and leads his people through the underworld out of it. And what does God bring into the underworld so it's swallowed up there?
Pharaoh
and the armies. Do you get the basic picture that you have here?
So he's destroying them on their own terms.
He's disempowering them. He's destroying them on their own terms. Yes, absolutely. That's a good way of putting it. Now, notice the pattern. So you have 10 battles. And there's certain recurring themes. It begins, there's a water turning to blood. The magicians, the sorcerers, using occult.
Dies.
No, initially they can do the same thing. They copy it. They can do it. Then there's the frogs that come out of the Nile onto the land. The magicians can do the same thing. But they can't get rid of the frogs. Interesting. So there is power in magic sorcery. The Old Testament doesn't deny it. The magicians turn it. And so since they can't get rid of it, then Pharaoh asks Moses to pray to rid the land of the frogs, which he does. And then comes the third. We're still down this domain. There's the gnats, probably mosquitoes, which come from the Nile underworld and are sacred in Egypt. The magicians acknowledge that they can't do anything with them. They can't conjure them up. They can't get rid of them. So that's the end of magic. Now, something very profound here. What Exodus is saying, yes, magic is real. There's real supernatural power. But where does the powerful magic come from?
Underworld
chaos. And that's what it's limited to. And magic has no power over Moses and the people of God. That's the first three. And then you get the three land ones. Some people say mosquitoes. These are something, could be sand flies or something like that. We don't know what they are, some sort of stinging things. And then for the beginning, there's a distinction between the Egyptians and the Israelites. These stinging creatures attack the Egyptians and their cattle, but not the Israelites. Notice, there's God separating his people from the Egyptians as part of the plagues. And you get the second request for intercession. The Pharaoh asked Moses to pray, and then he hardens his heart. Then there's the cattle plague. Once again, the cattle of the Israelites are spared. And then you get the next one, the last one, there's boils. The boils are not only on the Egyptians, but also on the magicians. Now, magic sorcery is protective, so the magicians can't protect themselves even from this stuff.
Why does God harden Pharaoh's heart?
I could just keep that question. Then comes the third cycle, the sky cycle, beginning with hail, and once again, God spares the Israelites. Only the Egyptians have the hail raining on them. And now comes something unique. Pharaoh confesses that he has sinned. He's in the wrong. Now, according to Egyptian theology, that's impossible. How can a god sin? By definition, everything that Pharaoh does is right. But he has to acknowledge that in the face of God, in the face of Moses, he's done wrong. He confesses his sin, and he requests Moses to intercede, to use the name of God to pray for him. Then comes the plague of locusts. Once again, Pharaoh can't do anything about it. He asks confesses his sin and he asks Moses to intercede. And then comes the most terrible one of all, the eclipse of the sun. Can you work out the theology behind the eclipse of the sun? Have you got it, Dylan? Yeah, explain.
God obviously hasn't risen.
That's right.
He's dead.
He's dead. And Pharaoh's power is can't do anything to raise him up. Eclipses cause crises. If you know Egyptian history at all, whenever there's an eclipse, there's a national catastrophe in Egypt, because it calls into question their whole theology. You can see why. It shows that something's failed in their system. So there's darkness, but notice that there's darkness over the land of Egypt except the land of Goshen where the Israelites are. You have a partial eclipse, but there's eclipse where there's one spot where there's no eclipse.
Which is impossible.
From natural...
Natural
scientific stuff. And you're dealing with supernatural stuff here.
Obviously,
yeah. And this leads then, by this stage, Pharaoh and his servants have had it up to here. They reject Moses. Why? Because for them to accept this means that they're basically that's the end of them and their power. And they obviously can't accept that. So they reject it. And then comes the most telling of all. There's the death of the firstborn son, who is the heir to the throne, and the death of every firstborn male in Egypt and every firstborn male in every herd of cattle and sheep. Now, the firstborn represents
power
and the, you know, the continuation of blessing. Okay, what's so significant about Pharaoh's oldest son dying?
He was the incarnation of the son god too.
Okay, that's even worse than the darkness. Not only does God show his power over the sun god, but he shows his power over the incarnation of the sun god, the next one who is the heir to the throne. Can you see here God judges and reveals the true nature of Egyptian theology? And what he shows is that it's power. There is supernatural power here, but basically what kind of power does Pharaoh use? Demonic power. So you get, this is spiritual warfare going on here. Okay, you said about hardening heart. How does God harden Pharaoh's heart? Now, part of the problem with this is our English verbs system. You haven't done enough Hebrew to know that in Hebrew, Hebrew distinguishes between three basic kinds of acts. There's the kal form of the verb, which indicates the way something happens. So I do something. And that's used, Pharaoh hardens his heart. Okay? He does it himself. How does he harden his heart? What does hardening heart mean? He refused to listen, he becomes stubborn, he rejects. Hardening of heart is the refusal to learn, the refusal to listen. That's what it means. It's an educational term. So, that's the one form. There's the kal form, which states a fact. Then there is the pi'al, which is factative. You make somebody do something. Okay? And then thirdly, there is the hif'il, where you cause somebody to do something. Guess which form of the verb is used when God hardens the heart?
The cause.
The causative. What God does doesn't make it, but it causes Pharaoh to get more and more obstinate. How does God harden Pharaoh's heart? By bringing Moses there and saying, "Thus says the Lord," he rejects it, and every rejection, after every rejection, Pharaoh becomes more and more adamant. His pride's involved.
That makes sense.
Right? Yeah, a lot of people have, and this is one of the reasons why you got to learn Hebrew. Because even explaining it like this doesn't show. You need to have a look at each case. What's the tense? What's the form of the verb here? There's no easy way of indicating that in any translation, which doesn't make it clunky and cumbersome.
Yeah.
So a plug for Hebrew. Where am I? Okay, then you get the Exodus from Egypt itself. And there's something remarkable. The people leave Egypt under Moses' leadership, and then all of a sudden the glory cloud comes there. It leads them to the sea. The Red Sea, the Sea of Reeds. It's rather vague, the geographical reference. And there you have God's final victory over Pharaoh and his armies. So it's not only that you have the eclipse and the Pharaoh's son being destroyed, but Pharaoh himself is swallowed up by the underworld
and his armies.
And so this is spiritual warfare, and the same place that God brings his people down into the underworld to save them from all underworld powers. Now this is a pointer to something else. Descending in order to save, going into the waters in order to save. How is this explained in the New Testament?
Christ.
Baptism and Christ's death. Remember the creed? He descended into hell. The third day he rose again. That's the New Testament equivalent of this. But this is the great victory. By the way, can I jump right ahead? You get a similar pattern to this in John's Gospel. You have seven signs in John's Gospel which point to the great sign, the great miracle. So if when we come to John's Gospel, you see that John reports seven miracles of Jesus, and each one of those miracles points to the great miracle, which is the miracle of Christ's death and resurrection. But it is resurrection, yes, death and resurrection. That's the great sign. So these 10 miracles leading to the great deliverance point to the work of Jesus coming. And then from chapter 15 through to 28, you get the journey from the Red Sea to Sinai. God's guidance, God's protection of his people in the desert. The place where they should die, God's present with them and provides food and water for them. Notice the main stories here. There's water that God gives to his people, grumbling at a place called Marah, which is bitterness. Bitter water, God turns to sweet. God gives them food in the desert. Remember the manna? And then later on the quails. God gives them water from the rock. They grumble. God protects them when the Amalekites attack them. And then lastly, God gives them a legal system because it's too complicated for Moses to deal with. So there's a law system. The 70 elders are the Supreme Court of Israel. Now that's the journey to Mount Sinai. And then comes the climax of the book. What happens at Mount Sinai? And there's four big blocks here of material. And the basic focus here is of God making Israel his holy people. So the consecration of Israel as the holy people of God at Mount Sinai. They are already the people of God, but this is their consecration as his holy people. Uh, 19 through to 24 deals with two very important things. The first is God's theophany. Now, remember, I think I've spoken about theophany, have I here, or have I not? No, I haven't, okay. Theophany is the appearance of God. Now, the whole of pagan theology has to do with theophanies. God appears visually to somebody, shows his face, and then what does that person do? They make an idol for the face of God at the place where God's appeared, and that becomes a sanctuary, a holy place. You can go in all over India and you'll see this stuff all over the place. Millions of gods, millions of holy places, millions of idols. In each place where there's an idol is a place where one of the million Hindu gods has appeared to somebody, and there's a holy place, an altar there. Right? But notice there you get visual theophany. Now God appears to his people at Mount Sinai, and it looks like a pagan story. There's thunder and lightning, darkness, The people assemble at the bottom of the mountain. God's there on top of the mountain. You'd expect the climax of the story to come when the clouds divide and God stands in front of him and says, ta-da, here I am. But what happens?
They get a stone. No,
that's later on. God speaks from the cloud. So it is through his word. It's a verbal theophany. How does God reveal himself? How does God show himself? By speaking. And he doesn't just speak to Moses, he speaks to all the people. Now, if you read your book of Deuteronomy, you know that that's one of the themes there. God speaks to all his people directly from the cloud, and he speaks two things to them. He says, I am Yahweh, the Lord. He introduces himself by name. He gives his name to every single Israelite. And secondly, he says, I am Yahweh, your God. He commits himself to them. Notice how it's back to front. You'd expect God to appear and say, you must commit yourselves to me. But he turns it around. He commits himself to his people. He gives them his name. He gives them his commitment to them. And then he gives them the Ten Commandments.
So that's covenant.
This is the third covenant, the covenant of Mount Sinai. So God appears in order to make his covenant with his people. You have the preparation for his appearance, and then you get the making of the covenant. God reveals the Ten Commandments to his people. He gives them the law of the altar, because the altar is going to be the ongoing Mount Sinai. From this point on, God won't continue to appear to his people on the mountain. He will appear to them at the altar.
It's the third covenant.
And then 21 to 23, he gives them the regulations of how he expects them to live as his holy people. And then you get the consecration of Israel, 24. We'll have a very close look at that ceremony, because God makes them holy then by sprinkling them with blood.
And that's the national covenant.
That's the national covenant.
So individuals.
What was to Moses now is given and extended to the whole nation, and it's not just to the nation as people of God, but it's his holy nation. So he makes those who are already his people, his part of his family, into his holy family. Right. So what's at stake here is holiness, his holy family, and that has to do. Holiness always has to do with worship in the Bible. And then you get the ascent of Moses on Mount Sinai. So the people at the bottom of the mountain, God's on top of the mountain. He speaks to them, and then Moses goes on top of the mountain. And then what on top of the mountain, God gives Moses the instructions for the tabernacle, the priesthood, the divine service, and other holy things. So he gives all the laws which establishes the divine service for the Israelites. Yes,
is that Levi? What makes them holy? God telling them how to worship him?
That's partly.
Okay, because he hadn't.
But it's God. We'll have a look at how God makes them holy theologically.
He never told them how to worship him.
No, this is new. This is totally new. Yes?
So this in the New Testament, Paul says, I lament for my people because they have the true worship. He's going right back.
That's right.
To this theory,
yes.
Right back to this.
That's what he's referring to. And he says they have the glory of God, the God's presence in the tabernacle, in the temple. Right, that's Romans 9 that you're referring to, yes. And then as the sad thing about it, as Moses is there on top of the mountain, notice that place, receiving all instructions about the tabernacle, priesthood, the divine service, the Israelites at the bottom mount do their own creative Israelite worship. God has forbidden them to make an idol. He's given them his name to access him, but that's not good enough. They want God. They want access to God, so they do what he's forbidden them to do. Make an idol so that they can access God's presence. Make an idol so that God will go with them on their journey. For pagans, idols are means of accessing their gods. God has forbidden that. He's given them his name as the means by which they access him. But they do that there. Terrible incident. No sooner had God made them holy than they desecrate their holiness, they desecrate God's holiness with the worst sin of all, which is the sin of idolatry. Then after that, you get the... Moses deals with that here, and then you get the construction of the tabernacle and the consecration of the tabernacle, and the story then ends with God's glory cloud leaving the mountain and going into the tabernacle. So from this point onwards, the tabernacle becomes a mobile Mount Sinai. Just one other thing. There were three parts to the mountain. If you read the story very closely, there's the peak of the mountain, the top of the mountain where God is, the glory place. And then Moses had to fence off the mountain itself, and the part that was fenced off was covered with God's cloud. Only priests were allowed to go on that place. And then there was the area, the plain at the bottom of the mountain with the altar. What do those three parts correspond to? The tabernacle. The Holy of Holies, the Holy Place, and the courtyard. Can you see that there is a parallel between Mount Sinai and the tabernacle? The tabernacle from this point onwards becomes a mobile mountain, if I can put it that way. But not a mobile mountain for the Israelites to climb up to heaven, but a mobile mountain for God to be present with his people on earth. And that's what makes Israelite worship different from pagan worship. Now, that's the structure of the book. Just any questions on that before we begin to look at the themes after a break?
Yeah.